But you won one. You might win some, but you just lost one. Now, how come your talk turned cold? Gain the whole world for the price of your soul. Trying to grab hold of what you can't control. Now you won't flow.
We're just going to wait for people to trickle in.
I was hopeless.
Happy Valentine's Day. Every man want to act like he's exempt. Or it was a prelude, I guess.
Can't slip talk on the day of judgment. The movement similar to a serpent.
Try to play quick. Thanks for joining.
Consequences, no coincidence. Hypocrites always want to play innocent. Always want to take it to the full out extent. Always want to make it seem like good intent. Never want to face it when it's time for punishment. I know you don't want to hear my opinion.
How many paths do you want to choose
one? And if you don't change, then the rain soon comes. Win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just won one. You might win some, but you just lost one.
You might win some, but you really lost one. You just lost one. It's so silly. How come when it's all done, did you really gain from what you done? It's so silly.
Law. What you throw out, come back to you, star. Never underestimate those who you scar.
Good morning, everyone. Sorry, that was a no. You may have been enjoying the music, so we can put it back on later. Thank you so much for joining us all. Can you all hear me? Sound good? Thumbs up? Okay, perfect. Good morning, everyone. If you don't know me yet, I'm Cecilia Tellis. Thank you all for joining us this morning. It's Valentine's Day. We have a fantastic conversation awaiting us. My name is Cecilia Tellis. I am the Special Advisor for Inclusion, Diversity, Equity, Accessibility, Anti-Racism at the University of Ottawa Library. It's a very long title. I'm thrilled to welcome you to today's event, a poetic conversation with Elamin Abdelmahmoud, Awad Ibrahim, which is going to be moderated by Karine Coen-Sanchez, who's joining us this morning as well. She just doesn't have her video on, but we will see her shortly. Before, there she is, hello. Before I introduce our speakers and moderator, allow me to just share a few housekeeping details. So today's session is being recorded. So I'm just going to say hi to the people of the future who are going to be watching this. I don't know why I find that funny. I just feel like I'm saying hi to the people of the future. it's going to be funny. Closed captioning is available. So if you need that, so it's under the toolbar, show captions. So that is turned on. The conversation today will be in English, but questions or comments in French are welcome. So we will be okay with translating your question. So the Q&A function is open. So if you have a question, pop it in there. We love questions. Questions are fantastic. So with those details over, allow me to please introduce our speakers, starting with our guest here at the University of Ottawa. That's Elamin. Some of you may already know him. We were talking about fame and celebrity, and Elamin has said that he is farmer's market celebrity status. So like he's recognized at the farm, which I feel like is fantastic. Like that is just delightful. We love farmer's markets. You may know him as the host of CBC Radio's Daily Arts, Pop, Culture, and Entertainment show, Commotion. He's a former writer for BuzzFeed News. His work has appeared in the Globe and Mail, Maclean's, Rolling Stone, and others. He's the author of Son of Elsewhere. Can I show the book? Yay. This is a copy that he signed for me at the Ontario Library Association. I hold it dear to my heart. It is a number one national bestseller, a Globe 100 book, and a New York Times notable book. We love books, of course. Next in line, Awad Ibrahim. Is a full professor, vice provost. He also has a very long title, super long title. You might get tired of saying it, Awad. It's very long. I'm not going to skip it. It's very important. Vice provost, equity, diversity, and inclusive excellence, and holder of the Air Canada Professorship on Anti-Racism. He's a cultural theorist with special interest in economy of hospitality. So many interests, cultural studies, hip hop, youth, and Black culture. Popular culture, social foundations, social justice and community service learning, diasporic and continental African identities, ethnography, and applied linguistics. You will not get bored talking to a what. so many things to say. He has more than 100 publications. He has researched and published widely in these areas. Karine Coen-Sanchez also has a wide range of interests, is a doctoral candidate in sociology at the Faculty of Social Sciences here at the University of Ottawa. Her research include experiential education, place-based learning, civics education, youth engagement and activism, and interdisciplinary learning. She's a highly engaged activist, organizer, and scholar. We've had great conversations, Kelly and I. She has worked tirelessly to forge relationships and initiate systemic change among Black and racialized graduate students in Canada. So without further ado, please welcome our moderator and panelists. I know you can't like, we don't have the reactions and you can't like clap, but like I am like clapping very loudly here alone in my office. So welcome to our panelists and our moderator. I'm gonna let Karine take over now.
Can I hear the music like for 30 seconds more? It got me in the vibe. Like, can we put it back up? I was like this, like all through it. Come on. Right? Doesn't it open up the tone? No? Yes. It's not gonna happen. Can we put it back on? 30 seconds, I'm asking. Get us going. Yes. Let's all vibe to it a little bit. And then after that, I'll start talking. I don't hear nothing.
Just a simple song, and some don't know what they had till it's gone. Now, even when you're gone, you can still be reborn. And from the night can arrive the sweet dawn. Now, some might listen and some might shine. And some may think that they reach perfection. If you look closely, you'll see what you become. Because you might win some.
All right. Isn't that better? Right?
God, I love that song. I love that song.
Yeah.
So I was delighted, honored, and privileged to share a space with two amazing people. So I want to start by saying that. And I'm very adamant about sharing spaces, that there's always space to be shared. So it's not a matter of, because you've climbed up the ladder and you have a little bit of recognition, that it belongs only to you. So that's important. This is about conversation and dialogue and about sharing space and about talking about some real topics as well in the process of sharing space, having some real honest conversation. And this is why we call this whole dialogue poetic. And in the essence of Valentine's Day, in the essence of this title of being called poetic, I would like to read a poem to break the ice and get the conversation going. So the name of the poem is "What I See is Different from What You See." The author of the poem was 9 years old when she wrote it, and it was my daughter who wrote it. So I will just start it off with reading the poem. "What I see is different from what you see. I see kings and queens, you see animal. I see an empire, you see a village. I see culture, you see dress up. I see beautiful long braids, but you just see dirty hair. That's the difference between you and me. We don't see the same thing, but one thing we both can see is the disrespect. But if you open your eyes and you open them wide enough, you'll be able to see the beauty in what you didn't see before." This poem was written when she was 9 years old for Black History Month. I think it kind of brings into the theme of having different perspectives if we look at the root of it, and that's okay. But it's about also respecting the differences in the perspectives that we share. Mm-hmm. And if we don't have respect in sharing the dialogue and the perspectives, then we can't learn or unlearn and relearn and create consciousness and develop new ways of addressing various obstacles or barriers. So the theme of this discussion is to really highlight Elamin's story, the nuances of Blackness, what it is to become Canadian, and how we link that to the Canadian state in itself. So that could be sharing, immigration, in terms of global content. So in order to just open up the discussion between Professor Awad and Elamin, I will just ask a question and then the two amazing panelists can have the conversation. And it doesn't need to stop at this conversation. So what does it mean to become a Black Canadian? Streams of thoughts for you two.
Thank you, Karine. Well, that's a biggie, man. That's gonna take how much time do we have again?
35 minutes. No.
what an honor to share the floor with you, Elamin, and probably we're making history. A Sudanese scholar talking to
his
author. So we're gonna burn the house, man. That's what we're gonna do. But before I do that, with all seriousness, I normally do not recite the land acknowledgement. Instead, I physically bow my head in gratitude for our Aboriginal peoples across this nation. To whom we owe gratitude that we are calling this beautiful land of ours home. Let's begin with that. And with that spirit, I also want to extend pure joy, pure love, honest, authentic love out of my people, my ancestors, were supposed to be wiped out of this planet by virtue of colonization, by virtue of the Middle Passage. And yet they're here, and they're in many ways, more than we could count, they are prospering. I want to begin the conversation, Elamin, and I really wanted to have it as a conversation more than me talking, and the floor is all yours, but I'm just going to give you some cues and take the floor however you want to, with attention. Scholarly speaking, especially when it comes to methodology, but it's also when it comes to poetry, there is a tension between the biographical and the autobiographical. Mm. And what's understood methodologically is that the biographical is the autobiographical, of course, is when we talk about, you know, one's own identity, experiences, and so on and so forth. But the biographical is extending the personal into a coherent, scholarly, evidence-based, and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
I see that in particularly in Son of Elsewhere. But with that, and I want to give you another cues here that you can take it however you want to. I see there is Richard Rotary talks about what he calls the tension between poetry and strong poetry. And what he means by that is by virtue of being human, by virtue of the experiences that we go through, we don't have a script. Each one of us has a script that is different than others, right? So in life, we write our own script. In this sense, we are poets. But once in a blue moon, there are those who take this poetry and reshape it, remap it, rethink it, put it in such a fresh way that they become strong poets. In other words, they make us relook at the everyday in a different way. Again, I saw the same thing in your work, but also in your even reporting and journalistic work as well. So I wonder if you take those as cues. But also going back to the autobiographical, giving people a little bit of sense, especially those of us who, those of you, and I have, Karine and I and Cecilia have read your book and very closely, giving that as a cue to talk a little bit about Elamin, the autobiographical element.
Yeah. First of all, thank you. That is a very generous introduction and very generous analogy. Let me put it like this. The book itself was born out of two warring stories of myself. That's how I arrived at this book. That's how I arrived at the need to write this book. The first sentence of the first essay in the book is, "It took two stopovers and 19 hours of total flying time for me to become Black," which is to say, I was admitted into Blackness, and a Blackness that I did not have sort of an awareness of when I arrived in this country. And that's because you and I come from Sudan. It is, you know, a country where the idea of Black is reserved. It was reserved when I grew up anyway, for Southern Sudanese people. It was not a label that we applied while living in Khartoum. We would call ourselves Arabs. We would align ourselves with Arabs. And so we have sort of understood ourselves outside of Blackness or adjacent to it in a way. Or at least this is how I was taught to think about Blackness. And what I needed to do is come here and sort of reckon with this idea of becoming Black for the first time in my life. And what was my reaction? Well, my reaction was to run away. My reaction was to say, I don't want that, because everything that I learned when I was in Sudan about what Black is something that I am not interested in. I came here and the signifiers of Blackness that I saw because I moved to Kingston were like, you know, Ja Rule is the example that I keep using in the book, but it's because this was sort of like the overarching dominating presence of what Black looks like in Canada that I could see because I moved to a town like Kingston. And so I recoiled and ran away from it. And for many years, I sort of prided myself in putting a bit of distance between myself and Blackness. And the way that the book was born was me coming to grips with the fact that that distance that I put between myself and that identity, that was not the right thing for me to do. That I owed these identities that I had sort of sidelined for some time something. I owed them, you know, intellectual energy in terms of reckoning with what they mean to me. And these identities were identities like immigrant, because, you know, it's really hard when you come and you're 12 and you're an immigrant. So I sort of did my best to run away from that identity. And then, you know, the Muslim identity, that is a crucial part of my identity that I spent some time trying to deny. And the same with Blackness. And that's how the book was born. The book was born almost as an apology of sorts to my story that I said, I don't need you right now. And then the book sort of began as an attempt to reckon with, hey, what kind of person would do that? What kind of person would put these identities on the shelf and distance themselves from it? I think in a way, we're constantly doing that to all of our stories all the time. I think we're always engaging with our own stories all the time and picking parts that are useful to us and putting other parts on the shelf in order to create the story that you need to create about yourself right now. But that process is a process that needs to be interrogated. How do you come to choose which parts of your identity you pick up today and look at, which parts of your identity you put in a box and say, I'm not going to look at this for a really long time. And in many ways, the hardest parts of the book to write were the shame parts, like, what, you know, the shame that came with denying Blackness, the shame that came with denying being Muslim, or not giving that those identities enough space. The reason the book was so cathartic to write was because it was about accepting my own apology to myself in a way. And so to me, like, those are how those two ideas are kind of in conversation with each other. This idea of biography versus autobiography. Because if you were to deliver a straight biography, many of those facts would be true about me. I am Muslim. I am an immigrant. I am Black, you know, but I didn't want to be. What does that mean? What does that mean to my own story and my own telling of my own story? And then what does it mean to come home to those identities later? That's in many ways the journey of the book.
So Ja Rule.
Yeah, Ja Rule.
What's up with the story of Ja Rule, man? What's your couple of times? I mean, I counted like four or five times. I was like, Ja Rule, man, come, that's my boy, man, at some point, you know?
Yeah, Ja Rule kind of becomes the default villain of the first little bit of the book, you know? He's not really a villain. It could have been anybody. It could have been any artist. But, you know, it was arriving in this country as a Muslim, as someone who grew up in a Sudanese culture, I should distance myself from Blackness, and B, I should distance myself from things that are not Muslim. Kind of Ja Rule was like, this was like a perfect collision of everything that could horrify me. And now poor, you know, I go like, poor Ja Rule, he did not deserve
it. I know. I was like,
he was fine. In retrospect, he's totally okay.
I think so. But there's something really, really interesting stylistically. And I wanted to kind of start with that and bring it to Chantel in particular. And that is again going back to the biographical and autobiographical. You beautifully do the tension between the two. You almost theorize your life. You kind of very deeply and very thoughtfully kind of work the biographical, the literature in there, the deeply philosophical questions and insertions and hypotheses and so on and so forth. It was magnificent to see how that is done. And I really mean it in the strong poetry sense, because you were very in a humorous way, which is another layer that makes the book even more interesting. How was that style of yours? Like, how did that come about? And those arrows, the sections, the flow of the sections, and even the chapters. So I was just stylistically just thought.
All right, so let me talk a little bit about the style of the book. I'm naturally an essayist. That's my mode of operation. My next book is supposed to be a book proper, you know, that begins at the beginning and ends at the end. And boy, I don't know how to do that, because the thing that I know how to do is design an essay. And maybe the thing that I'm most comfortable doing is braiding ideas. I really like the braided essay format. It's the idea of like pulling different threads and then carefully layering them on top of each other to arrive at a certain point. I like to walk a lot and see connections between ideas and see connections between, you know, ideas of myself and ideas that are kind of out in the world, because you kind of have to, the most important thing that you could do in order to write is to strengthen your own ability to observe. It's all about your ability to make observations about your life, but just also just about the world in general, seeing connections between different ideas. And so to give you an example, like the chapter we're talking about, which is the blackness chapter, is the first chapter that's in the book, that sort of tries to grapple with this, hey, why did I reject blackness? The first draft that I wrote, it just wasn't working. And the reason it wasn't working is because I kept on trying to figure out, like, hey, where does this start? Because it doesn't start with me. It didn't start with me. You know, it's the origin point of this is not here. The origin point is somewhere bigger. Where is that origin point? And then you kind of keep trying to go back into an origin points, and say, oh, I am the historic product of the collision of a bunch of forces. When you identify yourself as a lineage, not of people, but also of ideas about self and ideas about identity, then you can sort of begin to say, well, how do those ideas intersect in me? And I was able to sort of go further and further back and start to go, oh, it begins with British colonialism and British colonialism, because of course it does. It begins with British colonialism and the ways that the British had a racial hierarchy. And in that racial hierarchy, they put the Arabs, you know, higher than the Blacks. And in doing so, they left a certain people in power over other people. And in doing so, that these people, my people, me, they learned superiority. And that superiority is not spoken in like particularly, you know, eloquent language. It's like pretty crass, it's pretty direct. It's quite racist quite often. And then you kind of think to yourself, well, why would I be special? Why would I have not internalized these ideas when I grew up around them? Of course I did. And so then you kind of begin the careful tracing of layering history with these ideas, right? Of saying, okay, if we know that racism and colonialism taught my people to think this way about what blackness is, where does that show up in my life? Well, that shows up in recoiling from Blackness. That shows up in saying, oh, I cannot be, you know, a part of that. And so I think it's just a muscle of observation of your own thoughts and then getting curious of like, oh, I think like this. Where did that come from? And do I really believe that? I think you have to get a little bit curious about the origin points of your beliefs, which is hard because our natural judgment, our natural instinct is not to judge those beliefs, you know? But like, you kind of have to look inwards and say, oh, I have this belief and it is not okay for me to believe this. What am I going to do about that? And then you begin the work of challenging yourself and challenging your story by just exposing it. Be like, oh, I used to think this because I come from this lineage.
Yeah. It was really almost cringing. It was brutally honest.
Tell me more about that. Kind of like, because I want to talk to you about this because you grew up in something. This would have been familiar.
I'm writing an essay, that's for sure, on it, because what I would qualify as whiteness in the most unexpected place.
Yes.
So yeah. it was just realizing there's whiteness working here. And so it was really interesting to kind of
white supremacy is at work wherever
exactly
wherever you look, right? Like, yeah,
exactly. Yeah. And so it was really interesting, and which brings me to Chantel.
And talking about Chantel, let's do it.
Chantel, man. What's up with Chantel?
Chantel is she's a lawyer in Toronto. We haven't spoken in some time. Yeah. It's not her real name, but. She will go. So the point that I make in the book is that like Chantel is this person who I met at Queen's University, who recognized my own Blackness before I saw it. Like there's something sort of liberating about somebody saying, no, you're a part of us. Whenever you're ready to embrace that, please come be a part of us. And she ran a magazine that was like an anti-racist magazine, and she ran a couple of campus groups that were, you know, that sort of focused on racism on campus. I went to Queen's University. And, you know, the thing that I write in the book is that, like, when I got to Queen's, and my dad moved from Sudan. We moved to Kingston, Ontario, when I was 12. And I lived in Kingston for several years before I went to Queen's, for 6 years before I went to Queen's. And I got to Queen's, and I was like, this is the most diverse. It doesn't get more diverse than this, you know? And then I had to sort of learn that even though that was my experience, there was still deep racism at work in the institutions somewhere that, you know, there's a lot of focus on weeding it out. There's a lot of, by the time, I guess still now, there's a lot of protesting that was happening. There's a lot of campus organizing that was happening to talk about this racism and name it. And Chantel was this person, this figure in my life who, I mean, she wasn't there for a very long time, you know, but it's just sometimes you meet people who make you suddenly aware of that a conversation is relevant to you, that you're not separate from this other conversation, and you need those people, and you can never really like look for them. They just kind of happen to you somewhere in your life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Would you, and this is just a straight up question and probably a hypothesis as I was reading your book, would you consider that as the a radical rupture in your becoming Black, in your understanding of what it actually means on the one hand to be Black, and then what I call the process of becoming?
It's the break. It's the before and after. Yes. I mean, I think like my temptation was to describe it as like a dam that was filling up, but it wasn't. It wasn't like I was acquiring these notes and these messages from popular culture and from the world before that moment. It was just like this sort of, what Chantel did is sort of introduce a lens. And she said, here, take a look through these glasses and see if this applies to you. And then you sort of begin to understand that it does apply to you, you know? that I am a part of the story of Blackness in Canada, whether I wanted to spend all of my high school denying it or not. I met her in university. I think there's a real sense of, you know, we all kind of have these moments that sort of shift your relationship to an idea. And as much as we like to romanticize a sort of slow coming to grips with certain ideas, sometimes it is a rupture. Sometimes it is sort of like, it really is a kind of a before and after. You get invited to participate in a certain conversation, and before you know it, you have a new language. You have a new alphabet that you didn't speak with before. Mm-hmm. For me, that was the beginning of that.
Really interesting. Would you say, in your case in particular, becoming Canadian, Estonian, is becoming black. Would you agree with that statement?
No, I think I became Canadian first before
Say more about that. What do you?
Well, I mean, I think the nature of multiculturalism in this country, I think, allows for an undefined other, right? It sort of allows for an undefined kind of ubiquitous Canadian identity that can absorb a lot of difference without you having to necessarily claim a certain identity or a certain end of it, you know? And so to that end, I think I became Canadian in the sense of, like, I became more aware of the fact that I live in a country that allows for this variety of identities to be integrated together. Mm-hmm. And then the blackness came a little bit later, because I think the blackness was something more deliberate. It's like choosing this and choosing to learn about its history and choosing to learn about, you know, the joke that I make in the book is that, like, does it come with a certain set of, like, rights and responsibilities? Do I, like, get a handbook? What's happening here? You know? And of course, you know, like, that is not how this works. Yeah. How it really works is, you sort of slowly acquire knowledge and experience of being a black person, being treated in the world as one, and then respond to the world in the same way.
Really interesting. And the other, I know Chantel was one of the lenses through which you kind of troubled many things, but there was also women's studies, which became your major. I wonder if you could speak to that. And you just drop it in the book and then you move on. I'm going, like, come on, brother. Can you say more about that?
You're not the first person to say that. You're not the first person to say, wait a minute.
Just like Emily. I'm going, like, what? You can't just say that and just go.
So the story is that I started university with the goal of going to law school. I am not particularly talented.
In Carleton, among all places, right?
What's that?
In Carleton, among all places.
I really wanted to go to Carleton because it has an undergrad program in law. And my argument was, I'll go undergrad in law and then I'll go to law school. And I'll have all the knowledge from my Carleton undergrad. And I'll use that in law school. It'll be perfect. It'll be great. And then my dad said, no, you're staying in Kingston. And so I stayed in Kingston and I went into philosophy. And I was not bad at philosophy. I think, like, people sort of go, why'd you change majors in fourth year, man? And it's because, I'll tell you the exact moment. The exact moment is I took this class. It was a metaphysics class with Dr. Henry Laycock, excellent professor. And the metaphysics class, I wrote a paper about the difference between stuff and things, which is an insane distinction in the real world. Of course, philosophically, it's significant, in the world of metaphysics. But if you, like, go up to a regular person in the real world and say, hey, what's the difference between stuff and things? They would say, leave me alone. I have a job to do. Like, this is not, like, a useful, you know, way to approach the world. They go, please go literally do anything else, but stop bothering me. And it was kind of like, here's the thing. I got very good grades on that paper. Like, I did really well on that paper. And I had to sort of like look at myself and go like, am I learning anything? Am I learning anything aside from being able to like push words around? And is that the point of my university education? Because I don't think so. I don't think that's why I started to do this, you know? And so I started to think about, what I wanted to focus on. At the same time, I had a class taught by Dr. Dan Arluan at Queen's at the time, and she was teaching it was the last year that it was called Women's Studies, because the year after they switched to Gender Studies, but it was a class in Islam and feminism. And I will confess to everybody, I took it because I was like, well, this will be easy because I'm Muslim, so how hard could it be? And instead, it was a radical class in expanding my ideas, both about what Islam is and what feminism is, about my ideas about what capitalism does, about what patriarchy does, about what white supremacy does. And I learned so much in that class. I was like, I should be majoring in this. And so I switched my classes in my last term of my fourth year, and I took an extra year and a half to complete a gender studies degree. I was doing first year classes the same time as doing fourth year classes, but it was like, oh, I'm learning things that are pushing me. They're challenging to me, and I don't always, you know, find it easy to engage with this, but I want to engage with it regardless of how challenging it is. So that became for me.
I'm sure other people would love to chime in as well, but I have to close it with this one, which is becoming your pretty much your baby right now, pop culture. So there you are, 12 years old, coming in totally radically, geographically, climate, everything, language, everything different, and and you got so immersed into it that you are the pop culture reference right now, or one of the pop culture references in Canada. I wonder, what's the journey with that? It was fascinating to walk the reader through your journey with it, but I would love to just, if you can express a few things for others to share.
Yeah, of course. I think, like, at its core, pop culture is the thing that people want to talk to each other about because it makes them feel something. And I'm saying this about like film, about television, about music, about books, about whatever you're watching on the internet. You sort of engage with pop culture, and then you feel something, and then you want to share that feeling. For me, pop culture was one of the earliest access points to understanding what it's like to live in this country, because what you get curious about inevitably is not what are these people like, but what is the thing that moves them, you know? And so to me, the things that become popular, in pop culture now, even, they're a puzzle to me. Like, why this thing over all the other things? Because every week, you know, there are so many new movies that come out, there's so many new songs that come out, but one or two become the things that we all kind of gather in. And so pop culture is like a crucial part of the puzzle. You know, one of the jokes that I make in the book is like, you know, it's a bit puzzling to come to this country and then go like, why is Nelly Furtado singing about being like a bird? And why is this the thing that people, you know, that why is this song number one and not this other song? I have a natural curiosity about that. I sort of like, and that curiosity is kind of animated and made really my whole career. I sort of grew up observing all these pop culture elements, whether it's like metal music or wrestling or the OC, all is kind of like ways to explain the world around me. And I managed to trick enough people to turn that into a career. So it's not bad. It's not a bad time, you know, whether
not
it's
at all. Not at all. Because it brings me to one of the things that you do. And I'm really curious about this, this idea of elsewhere. You work with this idea of this idea of you have a particular idea or a particular notion of elsewhere, and I wonder if we can if I can just close my part with this, because it feeds into your approach to pop culture, your approach to your identity, your approach to Canadianness and Blackness and so on and so forth. And I wonder if there is a part of the book that you could share with us that you think would really gives the reader the essence of this idea of not only the son, but the son of elsewhere. So chime in.
I would love to. Do you mind if I read just very
quickly? Please yeah. Do. Yeah.
So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to read how the book opens. So this is before, before chapter one, we get to this prologue. And I will just read a little bit of it. I'm a student of migration stories. I am pulled toward accounts of lives rearranged by the journey from one place to another. If you tell me you're an immigrant or a child of immigrants, we are going to spend some time together because I will want to hear of the ways that you've had to stretch yourself to find your footing. Your story might include yearning for a home you haven't seen in some time, if ever. It might also feature the hard work of adjusting to new expectations, but neither the yearning nor the adjusting are the point. Instead, I'm interested in the constant calculus of how much of yourself to allot to each homeland and how you navigate the anguish that comes with giving one of them less. This is elsewhere. Elsewhere is the sharp contrast between the here and the there. Elsewhere is when you are compelled to note the difference in weather and temperament and attitude and air between a once home and a now home, just because you walked past burning incense that reminded you of another world. I'm going to stop there because I wanted just to read that a little bit. But this is what the book is. The book is about becoming comfortable with liminality, about becoming comfortable with saying, I really don't think that is home, but this isn't quite home either. You know, it's somewhere that is, well, somewhere else. It's somewhere else that is suspended between the two of them. And you figure out how to balance yourself between these two places. And there's often, I think, a bit of an obsession with grounding yourself in the new place. But my sort of temperament and orientation is to say, I think it's okay to feel suspended. In fact, I think it's okay to feel a little bit disoriented, and to welcome that, because that in itself is a gift. It's its own gift to be able to kind of carry somewhere else with you, even when you are in a certain place. It's a gift to be able to sort of have both conversations at the same time, if you will.
Mm.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what I call courageous conversation with oneself, in many ways. So I wonder if people want to chime in, Karine, if we have any questions from the audience or anyone else who would like to pose a question. I have plenty that they would love to be on talking, but I don't want to kind of control the whole thing.
Yeah. So. Well, thank you for sharing this these stages of evolution. I would refer it to an evolution of consciousness. But I think I want to go back and redirect the conversation in your evolution of thought in relations to identity formation. Because you touched a little bit about that. You said, I didn't want to accept Blackness because of the way I was conditioned and programmed to what Blackness is. Then I came to a sort of awakening to understand, wait a minute, I'm not disconnected from this identity. I was just programmed that this identity reflects this.
Yeah.
Do you want to talk a little bit more about the evolution of your own identity formation through stages of reflection and how that process was done? Because I don't think you're alone in this. In fact, I think this is very common and nobody's honest enough to talk about it. So what you did is that not only did you talk about it, you wrote a book about it. So that creates space for these types of dialogues to take place.
Yeah.
And there is, I don't know if, because I always conflict Blackness in Canada versus Blackness in the States. It's completely different.
Yes.
Blackness in the States, there is a sort of pride associated with it. I'm a Black American. I'm proud to be that. There's a history associated with that. We don't find that here. So there's I wouldn't even say gray. I would say like orbit, like a dark hole when it comes to talking about Blackness. Do you want to touch a little bit about your evolution in thoughts through reflection and through through identity formation that other people can listen to in their process of awakening? And I'm saying this lightly when I say awakening, but through their process of identity formation.
I'd love to. I think we don't give enough credit space to the multiplicity of Blacknesses in Canada. I think the US has a pretty strong shared history that is very specific to the US. We live very close to the US, and living so close to a large cultural behemoth that has a cultural industry that is associated with Blackness in the US makes that Blackness cast a shadow over our multiplicity of Blacknesses. But Blackness in this country is polyphonous in a very beautiful way. There's so many voices that are contributing to what Blackness is. I think there are beautiful things about that, and I think there are difficult things about that. The difficult things about that are you don't get one single coherent identity. So it actually like makes it a little bit harder for you to find your entryway, to find your very specific sort of entry place. I think the challenge is, for example, understanding that Black people in Canada go as far back as the 17th and 18th century to the African immigrants who settled in Nova Scotia and settled in Atlantic Canada. What George Eliot Clark calls Africadians, because we need a term for people who are like, we're here pre-Confederation. And their history here is not, they're not new, it's much more complicated than that. And then you have all these waves of immigration, you have the waves of immigration of Caribbean Blackness that migrated also to Atlantic Canada to work in like the mills, in the 1920s, all the way to the Somali refugees that arrived in the late 1980s and mid 1990s. And so we haven't united all of those stories of Blackness, which, as I mentioned, can be a challenge. I think it can also be quite beautiful to kind of look around and go, look at all these different colors and variations of Blackness. But it does make the work a little bit harder, because I think if you're in the US, you get a lot of notices with like family members who also move from Sudan to the US, is that they get conscripted, if you will, into this larger notion of Blackness, or absorbed into this larger notion of Blackness in the US. That doesn't tend to happen here. You sort of have to find your own way in, depending on how your people do it here. And in my particular case, because my dad moved to Kingston, and I didn't have a lot of variety of Blacknesses available to me, to literally just examples of it, it took a bit of time. And it took a bit of time to sort of deprogram my own idea of that I was carrying with me what I had arrived to this country with, of like what it means to be Black. And it took literal actual examples, meeting people in the world to go, oh, we have something in common. We have a history in common. And it's not as, imposing from above as, the American version, but it's something else entirely. And we kind of have to, we're still crafting this language, this sort of shared language. I don't think that's a bad thing. I think in fact, it's quite a good thing. It's going to take a little bit longer.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we have a question. I can't see it. Karine, do you have access to it?
No, I think there's a question.
I can see it. Yeah.
Good. Okay.
Perfect. Let me just read it out loud. Yeah. It's a, thank you so much for the gift of your self-reflection. Well, that's nice. Thanks, Felicity. I have a question about your intertextual dialogues, your conversations you might be having when you write with the polyphony of Black writing, spoken word voices, and diasporic geographies. Who are you reading and writing alongside? You know, a book that really, thank you for your question, a book that really informed my, a book that really informed my voice, the specific voice I was trying to find when I was writing this book, is They Can't Kill Us Until They Kill Us by Hanif Abdurraqib. And Hanif is a writer from Columbus, Ohio. He's a brilliant writer. And he wrote this incredible collection of essays called They Can't Kill Us Until They Kill Us. And it is also a pop culture. He's a music critic, a music writer. It is also a pop culture sort of lens, but he uses pop culture as this larger lens into the world. And reading what Hanif is able to do in that book, I really like books that sort of expand your own freedom and your own ability to do something else with the text. So there are writers that you read and go, oh, I didn't know you could do that. And now because of this book, you know, I feel like I can do that, you know? And so Hanif Abdurraqib is probably going to be the person that I mentioned first here.
I think we need to go back to the concept of artistry and poetry and what does that mean to you? Because you did introduce that concept in your book. How do you find that art was part of the trajectory of your identity formation? How did art play a role? And did it play a role? And when I say art, it can be poetry, music, anything that's artistic. Do you want to shed some light on that?
Yeah, of course. I think like the beautiful thing about pop culture is that like you look to it to sort of house you in a way, you know, to sort of expand your own sense of self. I want to mention an author that I really love is Rebecca Solnit. And Rebecca Solnit is probably one of my favorite authors. She wrote a gorgeous book called A Field Guide to Getting Lost. And again, it's that permissiveness. Like you sort of see a work of art that allows you a greater expanse, a greater terrain, a greater freedom to just explore yourself in a way. But also I have this orientation where I'm watching a movie and I'm trying to sort of say, this movie is making an argument about the way that I live my life. What is that argument? And how should I take that? How seriously should I take that argument? And this goes from anything from like watching a teen drama like The OC, you know, which is like, it's very like over the top portrayals of love, but also it kind of made me into a bit of a romantic, you know, to like a movie that I watched yesterday, which is All of Us Strangers, which is like a movie that you come out of and you're weeping by the end of it. I think sometimes we look at art as entertainment and that's fine. But if you sort of like open yourself up to text to see like, now this text might change me, how can it change me? It's just a sensitivity that you should, if you can, develop and spend some time with them.
I do want to come back to Hanif bit more in a broader sense they're similar to Chantal. They're markers, they're anchors in our lives that really just is just similar to your, you know, women's studies course. It just changes things. What are the few, and it could be one, could be more than one text that you find yourself going back to, that you find yourself that, and it could be any piece of art, any kind of piece of writing, any piece of an author in particular, it can be that you find yourself like not only grapple with, but you come back to more time than once.
It's not going to be a cool answer. I regret to inform you this, but
I apologies accepted. So
I do apologize. You know, this is not actually even really related to identity formation, but the movie that I have watched the most, and I have to preface this by saying I am not a fan of baseball and I don't understand it. But the movie that I watched the most is actually Moneyball. Brad Pitt, Moneyball. But the reason I return to that movie a lot is that I think it asks a question that haunts me a lot. I think the central question of Moneyball is, if you right now were in the middle of a revolution, would you know it? Would you look around and recognize that everything is changing? Mm-hmm. Because Moneyball is fundamentally about, you know, here's like a coach who, a manager of a baseball team, who's being shown, hey, here's a new way that's going to change everything you know about everything you do. Do you have the courage to say, this is a turning point? I'm now going to do everything differently. Or do you choose to ignore it? And I think we're always, all the time, presented with these moments of, hey, this could be a revolution. Would you recognize it? This could be something that changes the way we do everything. Do you recognize it? And quite often, my answer is like, I don't think so, actually. I don't think I have like the awareness and the presence to go, oh, this has a potential to change everything that there is about everything that we do. And I say this having lived through several revolutions just in my lifetime. And I don't mean revolutions as in like capital R revolutions, but I mean, you know, someone being like, you should download this new app. It's called Uber. And me being like, no one needs that. Why would you ever, you know, need that? And then 15 years later, here we are, you know? I don't think anyone would have predicted that, you know, Tinder would upend personal relationships and how people begin to date the way that it did, but it did that in a span of 10 years or so. So I'm quite often looking around. I have a daughter who's she's turning 7 in April, and I'm constantly occupied by what are the moments that I'm living through now, where later she's going to say, what the hell, Dad? Why did you behave that way when you could have behaved in this entirely different way? So I think I'm like naturally oriented towards like trying to find these like break points in history, and whether I'm living through them, whether I recognize them and then behaved accordingly in those moments. It's not a cool answer, but if you watch Moneyball,
I must admit it's the coolest answer, because it basically goes back to revolution will not be televised, right?
Yes. No one's gonna tap you on the shoulder and tell you this is happening.
There you go. So that's what it is, right? So it's in the daily, the aha moment that happens in the most unexpected time or unexpected place or circumstances for that matter. Yeah. So
when history happens, you're not going to get a Zoom invite. You know what I mean? Like, it's not, nobody's going to say, hey, we are now doing and thinking about everything differently. You just sort of have to observe the tides and say, there, I see it there. And that's where I'm going to go. And it's a muscle, and it's not an easy muscle to develop, but it's also like, it's really important when it works. And if you watch that movie, it's kind of all there. Like, it's all there in these like little tensions, because if you believe that this revolution was coming, if you believe that this is the right way to go, you start living your life differently right now. That's the question.
And just closing with this idea of history, and I think we are making history in some shape or form, that we're hosting you at the University of Ottawa for the first time. So, heart to heart. And if you can put your, not only book, but keeping your daughter in mind, keeping Emily in mind, as I hope I'm not divulging too much. It's in the book, so
look, yeah, it's totally fun.
And maybe it's a little bit tangent, but it's really in the heart. It's the kernel of your work. This historical moment, this space and time. And I mean, you are in Toronto, we're in Ottawa, and it's freezing in Ottawa, by the way, just to let you know. So I'm just saying. Yeah. How, with your broad perspective, what's your read, both at the philosophical level, and I know that's your background, but also at a larger perspective in terms of the cultural umbrella. And I know I'm giving you a huge question to answer.
Sure.
But this is a very interesting moment. Mm-hmm. I think that needs a little bit of pause. And it's like the fish and the water, right? Sometimes it was said that if the fish is asked to think about something, mm-hmm. the last thing it would think about is water, because it's all mm-hmm. around it. So if you can just have the bird's view, I don't know what your read is.
It's not an easy moment. You're sort of living through a slow changeover in history. We never seem to, in these moments, have the long view of history. We always have sort of like a shorter view of where we are right now. And so I think maybe I would remind people that, you know, the modern age of empire started around 1500s, somewhere around the 1500s, a little bit later than the 1500s. And we've been in that modern change. We've been in that modern era of empire for 500 years. And then we have tricked ourselves into believing after World War II ended that suddenly empire was no more. And we've done away with the idea that colonialism sort of informs all of our daily lives, because we've sort of tricked ourselves into believing that we've entered this international liberal order that is going to spread democracy everywhere, and then suddenly everybody's equal on Earth. They're not. And we are learning the consequences of that in lots of different places on Earth, right? Whether it is the occupation of Palestine, or the ways that we are dealing with climate change, or the ways that we are understanding indigenous rights in this country through the land back movement, we're still sort of dealing with the idea that there's a global class of people that has power over another global class of people. Just because we've internationalized that without borders does not mean that we've gotten rid of the fundamental colonial thinking. Mm-hmm. Naomi Klein has her new book, Doppelganger, is terrific, absolutely incredible. And one of the points that she sort of raises around it is this idea that every Iron Dome will fail. This notion that like every way that people try to maintain power over other people and deny them their freedom does eventually end up failing. And this is maybe, to me, my read is that we are in that moment. We are in that moment of, we are having all these conversations about, you know, immigration, the role of immigration in this country. Why are people coming here? Is it possibly because their homes, wherever they come from, are at the moment not inhabitable because of wars, you know? Mm-hmm. And you're seeing this happen quite a bit in the United States, where the U.S. is dealing with an influx of immigrants and it is not sure what to do with all of them. I think we have to recognize that there are consequences to climate change that's going to create a global climate refugee crisis that is going to create a lot of conversations about what we consider our right to protect, because if we are willing participants in creating the climate crisis, and then we have to also be willing participants in understanding the consequences of that in terms of people who are just trying to find some freedom from the circumstances that we have maybe created. And so we are just at the beginning of this. I think we have to remember also, like, history tends to be kind of long. It takes a bit of time for these, you know, patterns to unfold. We are just at this sort of inflection point. Do I know where it goes from here? No, I don't. But also to just remember that, like, we are, you know, if you get 80 years on this earth, first of all, congratulations. And second of all, that is but a brief blip in this long history of colonialism that, like, if you seek to undo, it's not like you know, you say, well, for 500 years we had empire, and then we're like, we're done with that. All of that goes away in 50 years. It doesn't. It has consequences. Those consequences kind of propel us forward. They inform how you think about your own identity. They inform how you think about your safety. They inform how you think about the freedoms that are available to you that you think you should deny other people. I think we'll be remembered. This era will be remembered for beginning to ask these questions. I don't think we're going to answer them. I think we're going to be sort of like the Middle Ages, in the sense that we don't have answers for those really big questions, but we'll begin maybe posing them. That's my big long view. But you know, you ask me a question, I'm like, we should talk about that for an hour, you know. But yes.
Thank you so very much. I know we are a little bit over time. You've been generous, but you gave us a lot to think about. There's a lot that I hope some of our grad students have taken notes on. You know, there's at least few essays that can be written out of elsewhere. Thank you so much, Elamin. I turn it over to Cecilia and Karine.
Yeah, thanks you so much. I know we were a little bit over. Elamin, Awad, Karine, this was fantastic. I took so many notes. I'm one of those nerds who like takes notes and maybe screenshots. I'm just saying. Thank you to all the attendees. Thanks for those of you who stuck around a few minutes later. This is going to be recorded, so we'll share that out once it's available, so folks who couldn't make it will be able to see it. But otherwise, I'm going to wish everyone a happy Valentine's Day. I know, like, you know, it's
love it.
It could be polarizing. I don't know, but let's celebrate love in all its forms. It's delightful.
I don't think it should be polarizing. I think you should be. I think that's.
It's dumb. I know.
Yeah.
True. So thank you all for attending. I will let you all go enjoy the day. Yes.
Karine, go for it. Where we can buy his book?
Maybe, totally.
Maybe we should put it in the chat for everyone to know if they're.
Hey.
Yes.
If you want to buy the book, you can find it hopefully at your local bookstore.
Yeah.
You'll probably find it in any bookstore, but like, go to an indie, you know, they're the best.
Find an indie bookstore.
There's one near you.
Yeah.
And say, tell them I sent you. I don't think
we also have a copy in the library. Just saying, like, you could
love that.
I mean, of course.
Yes.
It's a library.
By all means. So. Go to the library. Listen, I'm married to a library.
I know. It is a small world, the library world. There are like lots of library people on this call right now, and it looks like they're like sticking around. Stick around, friends, if you want, but we're also free to enjoy the day.
Love that.
So thank you.
Thanks for having me, you guys. I really appreciate it.
It was a delight. Mm-hmm. Okay, we're getting thanks from folks in the who attended. I don't know if you can. Oh, yeah, you can see it.
Oh, yeah, I can see that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, good. I know. Wanted to have the reactions thing so we could see like the hearts, but we can't. But then it would have been a meeting, and then it would have been chaos in the chat because my uOttawa friends are a little chaotic in the chat. Or maybe that's just me. I'm talking about myself. I love the chat. The chat is great. It's great for us, like introverts who, you know,
yeah,
like the words and just want to stick it in there. We're getting some hearts. Thank you, Megan. Yay.
Thank you, folks. Really appreciate it.
Have a wonderful day.
And you too.
Okay.
Thanks, guys.
Bye-bye.
Have a good day. Thanks for doing this.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.